So we are in the second day of the conference, Cognitive Neural Mechanism of Human Memory. Welcome again. Please let me tell you again that we are in the fourth edition of Cognitive Science Conference. And then this conference, like the others, is jointly organized by the Department of Psychology from Babeș-Bolyai University and the Romanian Association of Cognitive Sciences. We have very special key speakers. I introduced to you yesterday, but I will do once again today. So Professor Martin Palmer, Professor Daniel Schachter, Professor Maurice Moscovich, Professor Elinor Maguire, and Professor William Hurst. Thank you once again for their positive answer to our invitation. Also, let me mention today, like yesterday, our sponsors. First of all, my colleagues, Professor Juana Vega and Professor Andrei Miu, and some companies, Consult Plus, Cognitron, Pennsylvania Bank, and Medical System MedLife. Thank you to all of them for their support and their dedication. So for today, we have in the morning two speakers. Maybe first Professor Maurice Moscovich, and then after the coffee break will be Professor Elinor Maguire. Let me just in several minutes to tell you something about Professor Maurice Moscovich. He's professor of psychology at Toronto University, Canada. Also staff scientist at the Rothman's Research Institute and Glassman Chair in Neuropsychology and Aging. He was elected a fellow of several organizations in Division 3 and 6 of ADA, fellow of the Royal Society of Canada, fellow of the Society for Experimental Psychology, and so on. He has also got several important awards, like Hebb Award from Canadian Society for Brain Behavior and Cognitive Science, award from William James for lifetime scientific contribution from the Association of Psychological Science, and in 2012, the Distinguished Career Contribution Award from the Cognitive Neuroscience Society and the Distinguished Career Award from International Neuropsychological Society. His research interests include topics like memory, face recognition, attention, and so on. He has over 300 articles and peer contribution in volumes, chapters, and volumes focus on the related topics that I mentioned before. And now, something about him behind the scientific aspects or professional aspect. He told you yesterday that he was born in Bucharest in 1945, and he left Romania when he was just 4 years old,
yeah,
and then when he was 7 years old, he left Israel and established in Canada. I have to recognize that I have several personal memories regarding Professor Maurice Moscovich. In 1997, he was for the first time here like a scientist. Special key speaker invited at the time with the support of Professor William Hurst. And I will mention just two moments. Even though it was at that time the most important figure for our conference, my blade, I forgot to put him in the book abstract. Yes, because I put on the first page Serge Moscovich. He was also invited in the conference, but somebody misunderstood that Maurice Moscovich would be here live and the other just with some papers. So it was the first mistake. And I realized the mistake just in the opening ceremony, just before his talk. And I told him, he was very relaxed. Then he asked me to prepare for him a special kippon. At that time he needed a slide scanner, you know, for transparencies. He had many slides. Asked me, so in order to be sure, to prepare two scanner slides. And we started to, we were going to start the conference. No one of them was out of order. He made relax. I was first of all yellow, and then I became blue. And he said, relax. Have you a piece of chalk? Yeah, of course we have. Have you a blackboard? Yes, of course we have. And he took a piece of chalk and use our old-fashioned blackboard, and personally and my colleagues, we assisted, we were there to attend a most and wonderful talk using just the blackboard and a piece of chalk. He put there the brain, hippocampus, and then we had 2 hours with blackboard in our face without any slides. Thank you very much. I mentioned many times my students' the experience here and my experience, and I'm sure that it's not false memory here. After the conference, we spent some time outside of the city in the Danube Delta, and I forced myself right now because my English abilities, you can see, it's low. So I forced myself to express my interest, my research interest in a vivid discussion with Professor Maurice Moscovich. And after a while, when he realized that it's quite difficult for me to express what I did and I still do at the time, suddenly he said, "Vorbește românești," speaking Romanian. I was shocked. Because even though I knew that he was born here in Romania, he left Romania when he was just 4 years old. So he switched to Romania, and we had a very long and beneficial for me discussion about my interest in Romanian language. The last one, it was previous of before that experience. He was here in 1987 with his mother, and when we had the opening ceremony at the beginning, his mother addressed us in 4 languages: in English, Romanian, Hungarian, and German. We're more than impressed because she left Romania in the same year. 1949, yeah, or 19, something like that, 50, in fact. So a lot of reasons to be proud that people like Maurice Moscovich, he and his family, can do such a thing. You know that sometimes we have Romanians, they, after several weeks or no more than several years, they pretend to forget their own or native language. So here is different. Thank you very much, Professor Moscovich, not just for those experiences. Thank you once again that you help us a lot in order to organize this conference. And we have here for 3 days, like eminent figures from the field, because Professor Moscovich helped us to invite them and to be here together. Thank you very much. And please, thank you.
Thank you very much for that very kind introduction. It is terrific to be invited here. So far, everything is going very well. I'll hope it'll still go very well after I stop. We've also been treated so nicely that it'll be difficult to go back home. Here, we're treated as royalty. At home, I'm lucky if I'm treated as a peasant. Anyway, this is great. Just a comment on my mother. I always feel that, even as a kid, I always felt some kind of competition with her, partly because she would try to improve me so much, so I try to sort of do her one better. But she never had a high school education. She was really quite well-read, and she did give this speech that I was astounded. I didn't know she was going to give a speech when she came here. A few years later, Carlo Umiltà from Italy was here, and I told this to some of my colleagues, and he wrote me a note, said, I visited Cluj, and Morris, I should tell you, they have a vague memory of your being there, but no one forgot your mother. I suspect that's true. Anyway, I'll begin my talk, and let me make sure that I try to keep to the time. So what I'd like to talk today about is memory transformation. And before I begin the talk, let me just thank all the people who, I tend to go over time, and I often don't have time to thank everybody properly. So I'll start by thanking them at the beginning and then go on. So a lot of the work, almost all the work that I do, is done in collaboration with these individuals. Gordon Winokur and I have been working together since 1975, and the ideas that I'll present are ideas that I developed with him and with Lynn Adell. I've known Lynn Adell longer than Gordon, though we only started working together in 1996. Lynn Adell was a graduate student at McGill when I was an undergraduate there in the early 60s, and we hooked up again and continue collaborating. Mary Pat McAndrews was a former graduate student of mine, but now she's the head of the neuropsychology and cognitive neuroscience department, or neuropsychology actually, at Toronto Western Hospital. And many of the patients that I'll present come from her, but also we co-supervise graduate students whose data I'll be presenting. And Cheryl Grady is a colleague at the Rothman Institute, and almost all the neuroimaging studies I'll be presenting were conducted in collaboration with her. So let me start. Oh my goodness, that's what I was afraid happened. This is not a good sign for some reason. Oh, so how do I do this now? On my own computer I could fix it, I can't fix it now. It's strange to start a talk with conclusion, but it really, I did it because it actually provides an organizational structure. I don't know what happened to the, let me go, you'll excuse me for a minute. This is, let's hope that it's at the very end of the talk, but oh my, I don't think I can scroll through everything. So let me see if I can recreate this. This happened last time. I was here, I didn't have any slides at all, so let me see what I can recreate. I'm going to talk about the memories being transformed from highly detailed memories to memories that are more schematic in nature. In doing so, one of the things that I'd like to call attention to is the long axis of the hippocampus, where there are different specializations at both the anterior and posterior end. The anterior end seems to be connected to more anterior cortical structures, and its function is related to the structures that it's connected to in such a way that the anterior end, the kinds of representations are coarser and more global and thematic than in the posterior end, where the representations are finer grained and related to more perceptual structures, perceptual processing related to the structure towards which it's connected. With time, Well, you'll see what happens with time. The other area that I'd like to focus on is the ventromedial prefrontal cortex that's involved in schematic processing. And the interaction between the two gives rise to the kinds of rich memories that we have, and also to some of the more impoverished schematic memories that we have. So I'll try to develop this theme through the talk, and I hope the other slides haven't disappeared on it. So let's start with this idea from the quote from Burnham in 1904, which summarizes or the themes of the talk. By then, they already had some good ideas about memory consolidation and its transformation. And Burnham wrote, "The fixing of an impression, namely a memory, having a permanent memory, depends on a physiological process. It takes time for an impression to become so fixed that it can be reproduced after a long interval, which we would call consolidation, for it to become part of the permanent store of memory, considerable time may be necessary." So he's repeating himself. "This, you may suppose, is not merely a process of making a permanent impression upon the nerve cells. It's not just a physiological process, but also a process of association, of organization of the new impression with the old ones." And this will be the theme, how it is that these new impressions or old knowledge can help inform and form new memories. So it's the interaction between stored knowledge representations, schematic and semantics and schemas, with newly acquired detailed perceptual information. And by schema, I'll use a definition that my colleague Asaf Gilboa and his student Vanessa Ghosh provided. It's an adaptable associative network of knowledge extracted over multiple similar experiences. And the reason schemas are important, this was pointed out early on by Bartlett and probably even before him, is that they not only are involved in memory, but they color our perceptions. How we see the world and how we interpret it depends on the schematic knowledge that we bring to it. When I come and talk a little later on about patients who have damaged the structures that are involved in schema representation, they not only have very strange memories, but their perceptions and interpretation of what they see, I guess it's the interpretation of what they see, is also very skewed, suggesting that schemas come first in our perceiving the world, in coding memories, and in retrieving them. So just as a kind of preview, there are patients who, though they are in hospital, I think Martin mentioned some of them, a few of them earlier, patients, though they are in hospital, sometimes, even though the evidence, the perceptual evidence is to the contrary, they think they're at work, and they interpret the hospital experience as a work experience, and then have to, if you call attention to their surroundings by saying, well, do you have beds at work? Then they have to try to figure out, well, why is there a bed at work? But they can't move beyond the schema. The schema forces itself for them to interpret their environment in a way that's incongruent, or at least at variance with their perceptual input. So the structure that we'll focus on initially, the two structures, here's the hippocampus. It's situated on the mesial aspect of the temporal lobe, and it looks like a seahorse, and that's how it's derived its name. You'll notice now, and then I'll refer to this again later, that the structure is not uniform along the hippocampus. It varies from its head to its tail, and that'll turn out to be very important. The other structure that we'll focus on is the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, actually the medial prefrontal cortex, though mostly on this part here. It is subdivided itself into different areas. I won't get into that right now. And patients who confabulate, that I'll talk about a little later on, have a lesion in this aspect of the ventromedial prefrontal cortex. In the very first studies that on patient HM that Dan Schachter mentioned earlier, Penfield wrote the following. Based on the deficits that HM had, they concluded the hippocampus is needed to store a record of the stream of consciousness or sensory near experiences, conscious experiences, or perceptually rich memories. I borrowed the sensory near experiences from Martin Conway's terminology. So HM, when he was first studied, he had excision of the hippocampi bilaterally to control epilepsy. And the reason Penfield came to this conclusion is that he wasn't able from that moment on to acquire and retain new memories consciously. He was able to, some implicit memories or procedural memories were fine, but declarative conscious memories were not. But his remote memories seemed to be, I stress this now, relatively spared. With time, Penfield said, memories are generalized. By generalized memories, and these generalized memories are represented independently of the hippocampus in the neocortex and possibly other structures. So instead of generalized, those were the words that Penfield used, Penfield and Milner, we would talk about now memories are schematized or become more semantic with time. And those don't rely on the hippocampus. So here again is the picture of the hippocampus. And I don't know, is this clear from your... Okay. So if you look at the hippocampus and divide it along its longitudinal axis to the head, the region in front of the uncus, and the tail, or the region posterior to the hippocampus, to the uncus, not just the tail, but the entire region, there is some differentiation between them. Eleanor Maguire, I don't know if she's going to talk about it, noted that in London taxi drivers who really have to learn the topography and the street routes of London very, very well, have an enlarged posterior hippocampus as a result of their experiences, presumably because the posterior hippocampus is associated with all these perceptual structures that help them navigate. And you can see the connectivity of the hippocampus over here, the anterior portion and the posterior portion to the posterior part of the brain that are involved in perceptual representation and analyzing the perceptual content of the world, and the anterior portion that is more tightly connected to the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, to the anterior temporal lobe and to the amygdala, structures that in fact confer meaning on what it is that you're either recalling in memory or perceiving. Jordan Popping had the clever idea of seeing whether the structure, the volume of the hippocampus, is related to memory. Now, people had tried to do that quite a number of times, quite apart from Eleanor's own studies, and often they found that indeed the entire volume of the hippocampus is not very closely linked to memory. And his idea was, well, maybe we don't have to look at the entire body, but take a cue from Eleanor and see whether the posterior hippocampus is related to memory. In particular, whether it's related to the rich recollections that people have that make use of these perceptual structures in representing the information in memory. So if you have a very rich recollection, not just that you know something happened to you or you have a vague memory of an occurrence, but you could actually relive that experience, to re-experience the memory, to use some terminology, or travel mentally back in time, then perhaps the size of the posterior hippocampus will be related to your ability to do that. And indeed, that's what he found out. He found that performance on tests of recollection was highly correlated with the posterior aspect of the hippocampus. Interestingly enough, and this again Eleanor pointed out in her taxi drivers, the anterior aspect of the hippocampus seemed to be a little bit smaller, if I recall, in your taxi drivers. And indeed, what you could see from Jordan's work, that it's negatively correlated with recollection. The best value that you get is if you look at the ratio of the anterior to posterior hippocampus, which provides a very nice correlation with recollection, suggesting that the bigger your, not suggesting, indicating that the bigger the posterior region of the hippocampus is relative to the anterior, the better your recollection will be. Now, in the next slide, what I want to call attention to is that these two regions work together in a way that, in fact, draws on the anterior hippocampus's relation to the prefrontal cortex and the posterior hippocampus's relation to the posterior perceptual structures. This is a study conducted by Connie McCormick. Oh, my goodness, again. I don't know why all those conclusion slides have disappeared. I apologize, but I can't do anything about it. I already concluded the stuff for you. I hope this doesn't go through the whole thing. So what Connie McCormick did is had people recall autobiographical memories. And again, following suggestions, or not even suggestions, but some evidence that Martin Conway had presented and then theorized about with Pleydell Pierce, he noted that if you look at the EEG, you see that recollection or recalling an autobiographical memory, in recalling a autobiographical memory, there's a march from the anterior part of the brain to the posterior part of the brain as you recover the memory initially and then elaborate on it. And so what Connie did was had people recover an autobiographical memory by giving them a cue, and then they were told to press a key when they've recovered that memory. And then for the next little while, they were to try to elaborate that memory. Let's say it's a vacation, was the cue, and they'd say, okay, I have a memory of a vacation. Good, now try to think very clearly about a particular event that happened at that on that vacation and elaborate on it. And what you find is that initially, the recovery of the memory or the construction aspect of the memory involves the anterior hippocampus and prefrontal cortical structures. To be able to get the schema, in some sense, to construct the outlines of the memory. Later on, for its elaboration portion, it's not the anterior portion of the hippocampus that is so strongly implicated, though it continues to be involved. But now, activation in the brain goes to posterior structures. And these lines tell you something about the connectivity of the anterior and posterior hippocampus to these structures, and the thickness of the lines is how connected, functionally connected they are. The same is true not just in terms of episodic memory, though episodic memory is implicated, but even in some tests that are ostensibly semantic. This is a study that Sidney Sheldon and I conducted in which we gave people categories and they had to generate exemplars from those categories. One category that we used were autobiographical categories, they were called. And in autobiographical categories, you'd be given the cue saying friends, and you'd have to generate as many names of friends that you had. Or jobs, you have to generate as many names of as many jobs that you had. Another category was a spatial category, or a category that was informed by spatial construction. So for example, you're told to name all the items in the kitchen. And the way people tend to do that after getting through knife, spoon, fork, which are very probably semantically determined, and you don't really have to have a constructive search. But otherwise, what people then do after those first few items, and we have data to show that, they begin to imagine themselves in the kitchen, going through the kitchen drawers, looking at the cupboards, and so on, and coming up with exemplars. So they sort of used episodic memory to generate semantic information. And what you, And what we found was that, I don't think you can see it over here, this is when we compared activation in the hippocampus, we found that if spatial was greater than autobiographical memory, the spatial category generation versus autobiographical memory generation, you see much greater activity in the posterior hippocampus. But when you look at autobiographical greater than spatial, the activity is in the anterior hippocampus, consistent with our views about what these two structures do. This one being much more involved in fine-grained spatial memory or processing fine-grained spatial memorial information, and this one more thematic information. And over here you can see the differences in activation in the two sides. With when it's autobiographical, you can see it that the head of the hippocampus is much more active. When it's spatial, it's the tail that is much more active. So as memory becomes generalized or schematized, they become independent of the hippocampus. That was one of the thoughts that we had. So initially, memories, newly acquired episodic memories, are highly reliant on the hippocampus. But as rich episodic memories become transformed, they become independent of the hippocampus and become instead dependent on the neocortex. If the form does not change, if they continue to be highly detailed and not schematized, they remain dependent on the hippocampus throughout. And we wanted to put this to a test. And the rest of the talk will really be about seeing how well that hypothesis is supported. So what aspect of memory is crucial? Is it the type of detail? Is it the temporal and relational coherence of the memory? The subjective immediacy of the memory? I will focus right now on just this one. And I can, there are questions I can provide evidence or tell you about some of the others. So, in order to do this, we wanted to be able to get a very precise way of characterizing autobiographical memory so that we can get at these details. Together with Brian Levine, Gordon Winokur, and Janine Hay, we devised an autobiographical interview and scored the narrative that came out, that the participant produced, according to a classification that was initially devised by Marcia Johnson when she looked at reality monitoring. So here's a narrative. I used to play badminton with this girlfriend and I was very envious of her looks. We used to have lots of fun. However, one day we went from one building to another and so on. And then we try to characterize or classify these details as internal or episodic, those that are unique to the particular narrative, to the particular event, and things that we call external details or more semantic, those that actually are cross the boundaries of the event and are not unique to it. So here we go. The term I used to play badminton means it's an ongoing activity. They didn't just do it once. So it's classified as semantic with this girlfriend. And I was very envious of her look. She wasn't envious just once. It happened many times. And so on. However, one day, so that's an event detail. We went from one building to another to get to the badminton court. And there was an expanse, and it was wet and slippery, and she suddenly slipped and fell. All of these are unique to that event, and they'd be called internal details. There was all kinds, she fell down, it was all kinds of contortions and peculiar movements, and I was unable to hold back my laughter, and I heard her feeling so badly that she wouldn't speak to me again. So, we can now see just how well these internal and external details describe what it is that's going on. Together with Mary Pat McAndrews, Connie McCormick, and the other authors, we looked at normal controls as they describe their autobiographical events. And what we found, again, I hope you can see this, if they had very few details, so that their memory was, these people had more shallow than vivid, there was greater activity in the medial prefrontal cortex. However, for very vivid memories, there was greater activity in the hippocampus bilaterally. Again, consistent with our ideas that when we rely primarily on gist-like information, that is poor in detail but maybe rich in schema or semantics, then it's the ventromedial prefrontal cortex that predominates. When we rely on highly vivid perceptual details, it's the posterior hippocampus, or the hippocampus in this case. When we damage the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, as I mentioned, memories are distorted, elements are added, order is changed, people confabulate. I won't talk about this right now, but this is just a forerunner of what's coming up. Autobiographical memories, however, we don't know how to score them in terms of their veridicality. And we wanted to see whether we could get the same kinds of effects if instead of having people retrieve autobiographical memories, they would just try to be shown an event, a little 20-minute clip that's very naturalistic, and ask them to recall this clip. And we scored it the way we would score an autobiographical event. So here's a clip, a 20-second clip from a movie called The Red Balloon. Those of you who are of a certain age will remember it. It was very popular in the 1960s. I think it won an Academy Award. And it tells a story of a boy meeting a girl. Each one has its own balloon. And you go through this in the end, sort of the two balloons go off together, as do the boy and the girl. This is the gist of the story, but the gist of the story doesn't capture all the details that you see in it. So Melanie Sakaris decided that she wanted to examine these autobiographical, examine the memory for this story, and divided it now, not just the internal and external details, but we found that it would be better for our purposes to divide it into the general elements and the episodic elements. The general elements are the gist, and the episodic elements are those little details that if you changed would not have any effect on the story at all, but it would tell you whether you could actually re-experience the event. So this is the gist. If you change the gist elements, or these central elements, the story would not be the same. But the episodic elements would be things like she was wearing a white dress, they passed by the set of buildings, the sidewalk looked this way, there was, a brown door as they passed it by, and so on. I can't quite see it quite well at this angle. And first we did this study behaviorally. We showed people 40 film clips, and we tested half of them immediately and half of them later on. But before you even got into this, let me just give you the outline of how it worked. You'd study initially these clips. The clips would be given a name, boy, girl, and balloons, and at retrieval you'd be shown boy, girl, and balloons. You'd then have to try to recover the memory, rate its vividness, rate the vividness of perceptual details and story details, then verbally recall the story details afterwards, and we'd score it for the central and peripheral elements. So, for example, the central elements would be boy and girl each have balloons, boy walks away, girl's balloon floats towards boy, and so on. The peripheral elements would be boy carrying a briefcase, girl's balloon is blue, etc. This is one of the stories, not the red balloon, and first the subject is asked to think of the central elements. You could read along, I won't go through all of it together with you, and then to provide the perceptual details or peripheral details of it. And in this case, there are six central elements and 14, the subject provided 14 peripheral details. We tested the person immediately, 3 days later, and 7 days later. So they studied 40 clips, which were divided into three, and then we looked at memory. And what you could see from immediate test to 3 days later, there's a tremendous drop in peripheral details. And there is even a further drop by 7 days. At zero, for central details, the drop was not nearly as noticeable. We also wanted to see what happens if you give a reminder right before the last recall. So here's a reminder. And the reminder was just a portion of the clip that by itself would not help you at all unless you already knew what that perceptual detail was. And we found the following. When you do give a reminder, then memory for perceptual details increases, not to the point that it did at 0 days, but it's significantly higher than it would have been without the peripheral detail. The reason we wanted to do that is to make the point that even though the perceptual details are not recalled, they're available. And we surmise that the hippocampus might still be implicated in mediating them, if only the proper cue were given to it. So these are the conclusions of the study that I just told you. And now, we wanted to try to understand what is the neural basis of this time-dependent qualitative change in memory. And we did the same thing in the scanner that I showed you before, except now we didn't look at 3 days, we just looked at immediate and 7 days, because we figured that's where the action would be. And in the scanner, they got the film clip title, they had to rate the story content, rate the perceptual vividness, and then after they're out of the scanner, they were shown the story title again and had to recall the information in narrative form, and we scored it for details. And what you find, I hope I can see this, at the immediate retrieval, when you compare it to fixation, there's a lot of hippocampal activation and prefrontal ventromedial activation, hippocampus is not nearly as prominent. Once you get to 7 days, what you could see is that the prefrontal activation becomes more prominent, especially on the ventromedial aspects, and hippocampal activation now is much less prominent. It's been reduced in comparison to the way it was immediately, but it's still very much present. So there's a shift in activation when you're recalling these stories from the high involvement of the hippocampus initially, and some involvement of ventromedial prefrontal cortex, to a shift to more involvement of ventromedial prefrontal cortex and the diminution of hippocampal activation. When you compare the two, 0 to 7 days, it becomes clearer. Here's the greater ventromedial activation at 7 days in comparison to 0, and you hardly can see, I mean, there may be a dot over here, but I can't quite see it at this angle, hardly any hippocampal activation at 7 days by comparison to 0. If, however, the memory is very vivid, even at 7 days, you still get a lot of ventromedial prefrontal activation compared to immediately, though the hippocampus still seems to be somewhat implicated. So what we concluded is that the time-dependent transformation of episodic memory into more gist-like memory is accompanied by a decrease in hippocampal activity and an increase in medial prefrontal cortex activity. Highly vivid older memories, however, continue to recruit the hippocampus, though not as strongly as immediately. And we want to ask, and we've collected the data but haven't analyzed it, whether reminders that I showed you are effective in the behavioral study will reinstate hippocampal activity, and whether it will reinstate it primarily in posterior hippocampus rather than anterior. I don't know the answer to that question. With Kira McKelvey, who's a graduate student, and Melanie Sakaris is a postdoc, Kira thought, had this clever idea of trying to understand a little bit more how the effects of delay and typicality vary with time. And she divided the clips into those that were typical clips, in other words, the ordinary clips that people rated very high on typicality, let's say going to a movie and buying a ticket. Said, okay, this is just an ordinary clip, it's a highly typical activity. Two atypical ones. This one was that everybody rated as atypical. A woman's going to a grocery store and picks up fruit, and she squeezes a peach, and the peach squirts her in the face. And that was considered to be an atypical event. And what she found, not surprisingly, and somewhere neutral, what she found, not surprisingly, is that the number of clips that were forgotten when you're given the title was greater for neutral than either for typical or atypical, which did not differ from each other. And then she looked at the activation in the brain, taking a subset of Melanie Sakaris' data, and showed that for typical clips at encoding, there's much greater, when compared to atypical clips, there's much greater activation of the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, because these typical clips rely primarily on schematic information. You have your schema and you can go through it. By contrast, the atypical clips, schemas don't do everything for you, and you get greater activation in the hippocampus for the atypical clips compared to the typical ones. Phew, I thought, my God, this is plain. When you look at immediate retrieval, there's very little to distinguish between typical When you look at immediate retrieval, there's very little to distinguish between typical from atypical clips in terms of the hippocampus. Both rely on the hippocampus because your memory for details immediately is going to be pretty high even for the typical clips, though there's more ventromedial prefrontal activation for it. At a delayed retrieval, 7 days later, what you could see for the atypical clips, there's still a substantial hippocampal activation, some ventromedial activation. But when you look at the typical clips, hippocampal activation, and by comparison, is almost gone, and you get reliance primarily on the ventromedial prefrontal cortex. So as so story typicality affects which clips are remembered and the number of errors made during recall of those clips. Let me just show you these data because these are really interesting. And not that the others I didn't think weren't, but this is really a coup de grace. So what you find is that immediately the number of errors in terms of the kinds of errors you make in the narration, let's say saying that the girl wore a green dress instead of a white dress, you don't find any difference among typical, atypical, or neutral clips. However, 7 days later, your memory for atypical clips is worse than for typical clips. But the part that's interesting, your bad memory or your errors for atypical clips correlates highly with activity in the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, suggesting that what you're doing is relying on your schemas to produce details, but the details are now schema congruent rather than veridical. By contrast, when you make an error on a typical clip, there it's not related to the activity in the ventromedial prefrontal cortex positively, and it's almost significantly related to negatively related to activity in the ventromedial prefrontal cortex. So insofar as the ventromedial prefrontal cortex is not active, then in fact you start making errors on the typical clips. So what does damage to the hippocampus do? It reduces memory for peripheral perceptual details much more than memory for central elements. That's what we think it should happen based on these data from normal subjects. And so Marie Saint-Laurent, a student who worked with me and Mary Pat McAndrews, studied patients with ventromedial, with temporal lobe epilepsy to look at their episodic memory for autobiographical events for the clip and see how it works. And what she found is that the story elements over here, what we would call the central details, you get a bit of an effect in autobiographical memory compared to controls in patients with either left or right temporal lobe epilepsy. But the effect isn't large and it's hardly significant. Sorry, let me... when you look at the perceptual details, not the central elements, but the peripheral elements, this is where you find the huge effect. Patients with unilateral medial temporal lobe epilepsy or excision are very poor at recovering the perceptual details. They're not bad at recovering the schema of the story. And the same is true for the clip. Forget about the narrative condition. When you look at the clip, you do find an effect. Patients are worse than controls, but the effect isn't nearly so large for the story elements or the schema, the central elements, as it is for the peripheral details. So what the hippocampus is needed for is to produce these greater perceptual recovery, greater recovery of perceptual elements of a memory and representing them than it is for the story details, though it does have some effect on story details. And now if you look at the activity in the brain of controls versus patients, what you could see is that there's greater hippocampal activity in the controls and greater ventromedial prefrontal cortex activity compared to the hippocampus in the patients. So here we see the patients relying primarily on the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, even though they have one surviving hippocampus, whereas controls rely primarily on activity in the hippocampus to recover these memories. Ah, terrific, this conclusion is here. So, where are we? Where are we so far? The hippocampus represents detailed memories of episodic events from global to local details along its longitudinal axis from anterior to posterior. The posterior region interacts with perceptual structures in posterior neocortex and the anterior region with schema structures in medial prefrontal cortex. As memory is transformed from detailed to schematic representations, there is a shift from hippocampal to neocortical involvement. And both are needed for a variety of non-memory functions, which maybe I'll get to at the end. I started at a quarter to? I started at a quarter to?
Yeah, quarter.
What? 15 minutes. Okay, good. Is it only loss of memory that leads to reduced hippocampal involvement? So all this stuff on memory transformation that we talked about so far has to do with forgetting, essentially. And how it is that we retain a memory after we've forgotten some of the rich details of it. But schema formation isn't dependent mainly on forgetting, it's also dependent on repetition. Having experiences over and over again, and eventually you extract the commonalities across those experiences and develop a schema. That's one way to think about it. There are many other ways. So here I'm going to switch gears, and rather than look at memory for events, we're going to look at spatial memory. And the reason for doing that, there's two reasons. One is that the hippocampus is as implicated, if not more so, in spatial memory. this began with the work of John O'Keefe and Lynn Nadel in rodents, and has continued into work in humans, Eleanor McGuire contributed a great deal, and it may be involved in scene construction, constructing spatial scenes that provide the scaffolding or the framework in which events unfold. So we wanted to know how it is that people without hippocampal damage can navigate. And what we were struck by in the initial studies that we did with Shana Rosenbaum, I'll refer back to that study, is we wanted to know whether they have detailed spatial representations or just general spatial schemas. Patients with hippocampal lesions, we knew from reports of HM and other patients that they seem to be able to navigate very well in their home environments, even though they have no hippocampi to speak of, or hardly any hippocampi to speak of. It's damage to other structures that cause these navigational problems in patients. They cannot, however, learn new environments. People with hippocampal lesions, if they're placed in a new location and asked to learn it or to get around in it, they really are severely impaired. So it seems that for familiar locations, they rely on a schematic representation of the environment, and for unfamiliar ones, they may rely more on the hippocampus, in much the same way that we rely on the hippocampus in having good perceptual details of events. So we asked one of our patients, his name is Casey. He had a motorcycle accident. Dan Schachter worked with him quite a bit. His hippocampi are gone, effectively. This is what a control looks like. But he really is severely damaged in the hippocampus. But you'll also notice, if any of you are paying attention, that there's damage elsewhere in the brain as well. So impaired function isn't a big deal if you find it in him. What's really interesting about KC is if there are any functions that are really well preserved. If you look at his autobiographical memory interview, he scores very low on details about events in his recent life. He's not bad for childhood, but still well below the average. However, if you look at, these are for personal semantics, semantic information about him. But if you look at event details, the ability to conjure up an event in rich detail, he's impaired throughout his lifetime, as we might expect him to be if he has large hippocampal damage and the hippocampus is needed to retain those events. When we ask him to draw a map, of his home environment, he knows all the major routes, but his map is not nearly as detailed as that of a control. So even in terms of, he has a schematic representation, but not a detailed representation of his environment. And that's true if you compare him to other controls in the neighborhood who had left the neighborhood at about the same time that Casey got his lesion. And we conducted a whole host of tests of proximity judgment, distant judgment, vector judgments, and so on. All of these that relate to the schematic representation of the environment. So let me just show you one. Describe an efficient route from one landmark to another, given that the most direct route was blocked. KC scores just as well as the two controls who had been living there ever since. They actually have much more memory of the environment than he does in some sense, but his remote memory of that is fine. He's even fine on this vector task. This is a map of his area, a 1 square mile map. This is his house, and we ask him to draw a line going to the shopping center. He doesn't see this map. He's just given a blank piece of paper. We're told, this is your house. Draw an arrow in the right direction and the same length as the distance to the shopping mall, and he performs just as well as controls. So he doesn't just have no roots, he seems to have a good schematic representation that he could use to extract this kind of information. Okay, here he is performing just as well. In fact, he performs better than his mother, but that's because she reverses left and right. If you just look at her absolute score, they're the same as this. However, he's very poor at perceptual details. If they're not salient landmarks in the environment. So if we ask him, we show him some houses in his neighborhood and ask him to choose which of these is a house in your neighborhood, he's very poor at doing that in comparison to choosing a house in another neighborhood that looks similarly. So he recognizes some of the items, but he's very, very poor at being able to distinguish his house, or let's say a house in the neighborhood, from another one. So it's perceptual details that are damaged. So the conclusion for this study was that the hippocampus is needed for scenes, but not for maps, for re-experiencing an environment, but not for navigation. Consistent with scene construction and multiple trace theory, and it's not consistent with a cognitive map theory and standard consolidation theory, which I really didn't get into, and I won't belabor the point. We wanted to see, well, look, this just may be the case for KC, he has damage. What about normal controls? So we did the same thing. We created a map of Toronto. We used a map of Toronto. And we had subjects come into the scanner, and we asked them the same kind of questions as KC. What's farther away? This from, you know, different landmarks. Is the Toronto City Hall closer to the university than it is, let's say, to the stadium? We asked proximity judgments, asked them to follow a route and which landmarks would be along that route. And what Shana Rosenbaum found is that there is a lot of activation in doing those tasks in midfrontal gyrus, superior occipital gyrus, retrosplenial cortex, precuneus, parietal lobe, parahippocampal gyrus, but no activity in the hippocampus in conducting these tasks. This is where the activity should have been, but there was none. And we thought, this is really strange. Maybe it's because Toronto is such a grid-like city, maybe people navigate in it in a strange way. So we did the same thing again now with Marnie Hirschhorn, and we had her do two things in this task. Actually, you know what? Time is running short. Let me just switch to this slide. We had graduate students come into the scanner when they first arrived in Toronto, after they've been there for a few weeks, and gave them the same test, and then we tested them a year later. In the first few weeks, they're showing terrific, or months actually, they're showing terrific hippocampal activity, suggesting that as they're learning their environment, they're relying quite a bit on the hippocampus. However, by a year, there's no hippocampal activity at all. They're doing the task just as they did, as Shana's patients did, who had been living in Toronto for quite a while. So it seems that once you build up a really good schematic representation of the environment, you no longer need the hippocampus to navigate. Before that, you do. But you still rely on the hippocampus if you want to re-experience the environment. If you want to say, well, what color are the buildings that you're passing through? Tell me what... we tried this with KC. He could navigate in his environment, home environment, neighborhood very well. But if you place him in a particular location, or even ask him, not placing him there, okay, do you know where you are? I said, absolutely. He said, tell me what's behind you. He had absolutely no idea, whereas controls find that trivially easy. Again, we thought, well, this is all static. So with Jason Ozupo, we decided to see maybe the hippocampus is needed in navigating in familiar environments when it's actually active navigation. And so what we did, these are the questions that we asked, what we did is use Google Street View. He created a platform where he could download Google Street View, and then in the scanner, people could navigate in their home environment that was familiar or one that was less familiar. So this is parts of Toronto. One of the interesting things is that Jason Ozupo found himself on Google Street View when he was going through. So this is him being caught on Google Street View. He was very surprised. And so what we did is have people navigate in a low familiar environment that you knew. You start at one location and try to get to the other, and a highly familiar environment. The subject chose his own routes. He told us which, by looking at a map, which environments, which routes were familiar, which routes were he knew but wasn't that familiar with. And we had four conditions. The fourth, well, I'm only showing you three. The fourth one is a mirror condition, but I'm not going to talk about that. And what we did is looked at the hippocampus online, this hippocampus being active that we're scanning, as the person is going along this route. This is the trail following. It's a control one. He doesn't have to navigate. So just follow the arrow. And as you can see in blue, there's hardly any hippocampal activation. In the low familiarity environment, you now start seeing greater hippocampal activation. And we wanted to find out where along the route the hippocampal activation arises. And what we've, I don't know what happened. Maybe in transferring it to the key. So what this says, one, you can see in the low familiar environment, the hippocampal activation is high. But it's only high at intersections where you change directions. If you're walking along a straight line, it's as if the hippocampus, and this again, a precursor of this was an Eleanor study looking at taxi drivers navigating through London, there's hippocampal activation at the beginning of the ride, but afterwards there's very little. Here, if you're going along with Google Street View, it's as if the hippocampus plans the route, then goes offline, comes in again if you switch directions, and so on. It's not active during the other part. In the high familiarity environment, you can see there's no hippocampal activation. Let's see what's missing this time. Okay, so good. So in the high familiarity environment, there's some hippocampal activation on the left side, anteriorly, suggesting that it's maybe more schematic. But in the low familiar environment, there's hippocampal activation extending somewhat further back, especially in the right hippocampus. So I have 5 minutes, I think, left, or 3 minutes by my estimate. So in all these studies, then, it seems that schematic representations don't rely on the hippocampus. Even for things such as navigation, you can rely on other structures. Not so much the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, we think, in navigation, though it has a role, but perhaps caudate cortex. If, however, you want to re-experience the environment in great detail, then the hippocampus will come online again. So what happens when you damage the ventromedial prefrontal cortex? We didn't talk about that very much, and I'll just go through this very, very quickly in the last 3 minutes. What we believe happens now is that you get a corrupted or overextended schema representation and poor monitoring. So the ventromedial prefrontal cortex may be necessary for instantiating schemas and monitoring events or information in relation to that schema that's been reactivated. So that if you have a corrupted and overextended schema, you may in fact admit certain information and say it's veridical when in fact it isn't. It may be that you also have overlaid on top of that an inhibitory structure that keeps irrelevant information down, inhibitory function that keeps irrelevant information down and lets in only the right information. So it's a combination of schema representation and monitoring. What we find in patients with ventromedial prefrontal cortex lesions is that they have poor strategic search in the Galton-Crovitz task. So if you give them a cue, tell me, think of an event beginning that has to do with a letter, they very often, their most common mistakes, they can't think of an event that has to do with a letter. They have very great difficulty. When they do think of an event, it's often distorted and confabulated. So, for example, about the patient that we had, I'll just take a quick anecdote. We asked him, are you married? He said, yes. How long have you been married? He said, 6 months. He had been married over 30 years. He had 4 grown children. And then we asked him, well, how many children do you have? He said, 4. And then he giggled and he said, not bad for 6 months. And then we asked him, well, are you sure you've been married for 6 months? Absolutely. He said, well, how did you get these 4 grown children? And now he had to reconcile clearly information that is at variance with whatever schematic information that he had. And then he would tell us the story. I adopted them. So, he adopted a 32-year-old. He said, and he told us the best he can to try to reconcile these two bits of information with each other. Whoops. So there's severe memory distortion in the form of confabulation. And what's interesting, Dan talked about the false memory effect in normal people. One reason that you get that false memory effect is that you extract the gist from all these exemplars and come up with a false memory of an item that's related to these exemplars via gist. In patients with ventromedial prefrontal cortex, we found in 1999, now Warren has reported this again, they don't have a false memory effect because they don't have the gist to extract in order to be able to produce a false memory. In the last little bit that I'll tell you about, this is about future research or ongoing research, if schemas are important, you'll get a post-stimulus effect. That is to say that they'll be involved after you've given a stimulus and have to determine whether it's veridical or not. And you would be comparing that stimulus to the schema in ventromedial prefrontal cortex. And there are two electrophysiological correlates that I want to point out. When you're looking at familiar faces, or looking at faces, the N170, probably emanating from the FFA or areas nearby, is higher for faces than for other objects. But it's higher still for faces that you're personally familiar with than faces that may be familiar in general, but you don't know them. They're not your acquaintances. So we looked at the difference between personally familiar faces and faces that are not personally familiar. And the size of that difference correlated very highly with a signal emanating from the ventromedial prefrontal or orbital frontal cortex, the P230. The higher the P230 was, the greater the difference between familiar and unfamiliar faces, personally familiar and unfamiliar faces. What's really interesting is that we can look at pre-stimulus effects. Schemas, as I said at the very beginning of the talk, tell you how to interpret the world. Not tell you, but guide you in interpreting the world. And so we looked now at theta desynchronization with a locus, with a source in ventromedial prefrontal cortex, but we looked at theta that was pre-stimulus thetas, before any stimulus was presented. And we found that the extent of theta desynchronization varies with the N170 difference. That is to say, the schema itself, prior to any stimulus being presented, already will determine the schema, in this case for the self and what people you might know, will determine how you're going to interpret the information that you see. And in patients with ventromedial prefrontal cortex lesions, the difference here is very small, and theta doesn't synchronize very well for them at all. So, last of the conclusions, only 2 minutes over, that's not so bad. The hippocampus represents detailed memories of episodic events from global to local details along its longitudinal axis from anterior to posterior. The posterior region interacts with perceptual structures in posterior neocortex and the anterior with schema processing structures in ventromedial prefrontal cortex. As memories transform from detail to schematic representations, there's a shift from hippocampal to neocortical involvement, with MPFC playing a greater role. Damage to MPFC leads to corrupted or overextended schemas, which lead to impaired perception, encoding, retrieval search, and monitoring. And both hippocampus and MPFC are needed for a variety of non-memory functions, which I didn't get into at all, But all of them really are not in the not traditionally in the memory domain, but hippocampal involvement is now clear in language, imagination, creativity, problem solving, and even food regulation. So thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you once again to Professor Morris, his talk. Now will be like yesterday will be the answer session, but until you warm up with a question, until you reprime your questions in your mind, please let me to add something or that experience that I have had with Professor Moscovich. I told you that I was shocked when he asked me to speak in Romanian, and I asked him how was possible to preserve Romanian language for more than 50 years. And he said it was a family decision. Actually, my mother decided to preserve Romanian language in the family. Am I right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it wasn't completely her decision. If my father could not speak any other language, it would...
Yeah, therefore I said, because now there is a joke in Romania. A Romanian guy was questioned by the other who made a major decision in family, and the answer was I. My wife is implied just in minor decision, like when we'll have children, when we'll buy the house, and things like that. And I, personally, I'm very implied when the European policy has to change, White House needs help, and something like that. Okay, thank you once again. Thank you very much for your talk.
You.
And please ask questions for Professor Moscovich. Yeah, please.
Hey, Mark.
I was wondering about your queuing experiments, where you find the details that can't be kind of freely recalled, you can get to them if you queue them. There's a kind of implication of that, because those details obviously are there, but they're just not accessible
right.
In the free recall task. So my question really is, how widespread do you think that is? And for example, just this is what I have in mind. Let's say I encountered a queue. Right. It's somehow mapped onto some detail from a childhood memory. Will I then suddenly remember that childhood memory in much more detail, or do you think it's a short-lasting thing?
That's a good question. I don't know. The kind of cues we used here is not going to help you with childhood details. I mean, they're really very minimal, almost corrupted cues taken from a frame of the clip. And we did that deliberately because as soon as we made the cue a little bigger, the person got too much information and was able to generate the perceptual details from the from that cue. So we wanted it not to be able to generate it from that cue, but to use that cue to generate other things. In terms of childhood memories, I don't know what kind of cues are most effective. I'll tell you a study that we're doing that maybe you could look at children. This is Jessica Robin, she's very much into the scene construction support of event memory. And what she does, what we're doing now, is showing people landmarks around Toronto. And the landmarks are those that they visited either often or those that they're familiar with but had visited rarely. And we just tell them to look at, it's sort of an involuntary memory study, apropos what you're saying, taken from Bernstein, but we wanted to look at it in real life events. And what we found now, and we're starting to look at old people and see if some of those kinds of memories show up, what we found, at least in undergraduates, we haven't yet done enough old people to know, is that if they visited the location rarely, the memory that comes up, oh, they just told, just look at this and we'll ask you questions about the slide, but if anything comes to mind, anything, just press a button. And what we found is that if they visited a location rarely, or maybe not in a long time, then they come up with specific autobiographical events automatically. That's the most common. That's the most common thought that pops into mind. If they visited it often, they don't come up with autobiographical events so often. They come up with generalized, oh, I've gone to the library many times. They come up with general semantic, or that's the library, it looks like this and that. More with semantic or just like autobiographical events, but not with specific ones. So now to get back to your question, if you were to take, let's say, a person who had left Romania when he was young and was shown some pictures of areas where he'd been, maybe some memories that hadn't been there before might pop into mind. I don't think so, watching my mother look lost in her hometown that she hadn't been there for 50 years, but it might be the case that it could happen. Does that get at what you're...
No, it's a fascinating thing.
Okay. Yeah, then.
So, nice talk as usual. I'm just wondering what kind of qualifications you might want on conclusion number three up there. Because when I read that, I think, boy, standard consolidation theory would be happy with that conclusion. It reads like it could have been written, by
sure.
people with a different view from you. And of course, I know what you think, that detailed memories that last over time involve the hippocampus. So what are the bounds that you want to put on that conclusion that make it consistent with multiple trace theory?
Or trace transformation theory now, that it's evolved into, even theories transform. This is the way I think. I mean, you sort of already answered the question. Insofar as the memory loses its detail, it comes to rely more on schematic representations. And according to standard consolidation, I mean, the thing that we didn't like about it is that we saw patients and looked through the literature that, and then looked at neuroimaging studies. They really don't have very detailed memories. And the standard consolidation model said that memory is effectively, transferred is the wrong word, but a representation that once depended on the hippocampus now depends on neocortex, but the memory is identical in both cases, or at least that was what I inferred. What we're saying is that insofar as the memory is transformed, it no longer is going to be dependent on the hippocampus. If it remains highly detailed, it'll continue being dependent on the hippocampus. The non-hippocampal representation is different from the hippocampal one, but what we found, and we didn't expect necessarily to find it, is that with time, even if you have a detailed memory at a remote interval, I think you rely more on the ventromedial prefrontal cortex to recover it. And I think some of your work suggests that as well, that I think this goes both beyond the multiple trace theory and beyond standard consolidation theory to understanding the interaction between these two areas. Does that answer? Yeah? Okay. Yes?
I wonder what would be the relationship between the level of schematization of a memorized experience and the number of errors. Maybe when someone has to recognize that memorized experience in comparison with a very similar experience. In other words, when would the confusion be the two be the highest? In fact, two similar experience, one memorized, one low schematized, and one very high schematized, or medium schematized, when the confusion would be the highest?
If I understand your question correctly, is how do people confuse? Right. So if they have a fault, maybe what you're asking is this. Let me try to paraphrase. And if I'm wrong, tell me, and I'll try to answer the question you're asking then, rather than the question I think you're asking. So, are you asking if a person has a false memory, is it going to be more likely to endorse a false memory where there are a lot of perceptual details as opposed to endorsing a false memory where it's merely schematized. Is that,
yes.
Is that close enough?
Yes.
Okay. So I think some of the work that Dan mentioned yesterday applies here. We tend to believe very strongly that if we have a lot of details, even if they're made up, we tend to believe in those memories more than if you say, well, I remember being in Romania last time, I remember giving a talk, I just don't, you know, I can't tell you much else of what's going on, so if you tell me that we, you know, I was drunk and walked around the city in my underwear, I don't remember any of that, so I'll agree that, you know, maybe I have a false memory or a good memory of what happened. So I think if the memory if your memory is schematized, you're more likely to think that you're unsure of your memory and maybe that you've actually made something up. If your memory is highly detailed, we tend, just like people who listen to us, tend to believe that that's a really true memory. And we may be wrong in that way, and it'd be interesting to look to examine that more carefully. That's a prediction. I mean, Dan, is that something that you think is more or less correct? Yeah.
Yeah,
I think so. I would think it's a non-linear relationship. I think the confusion with the lowest in the median schematized.
I'm sorry, it's non-linear. Oh, okay, maybe non-linear, but yeah. Why? If it's very, maybe, yeah, I mean, in terms of general gist, indeed, the confusion might be low, but not if somebody pushes you. Just refine the answer. If they're going to challenge you on the gist aspects of the memory, rather than the detail aspects, then I think you're right. If they challenge you on detail aspects where all you really have confidence is in the gist, then you may be wrong. But we can talk about that later. Yeah?
If I remember correctly, one of the results that you presented was that people which are on a low down in fat don't create false memories that we see in the Beesbrodick and the paradigm. I wondered how much you want to push the fact that false memories arise because of that connection between frontal lobe and temporal. In that, I think that a lot of my false memories dwell on perceptual details. I remember that it was a yellow dress, but it was really a blue dress. I mean, it's not these larger. I mean, these Rodiger and McDermott paradigm creates a particular kind of false memory.
Oh, in general, you're talking about general false memories,
yes,
where we actually come up with a lot of details.
I mean, I think that creates a very peculiar kind of false memory.
I agree.
And a lot of our false memories are exactly the kind of memories you attribute to the hippocampus as opposed to...
Well, so here's the question. I don't think people have looked at this very much, although... So the answer is... Well, there's two parts to this answer. If the false memory only depends on getting the gist, as it does in this paradigm, then the ventromedial is crucial. However, even when you have a very detailed memory, and that's the part that we showed where errors are made that vary according to how activated the ventromedial prefrontal cortex is, it suggests that your constructing the memory depends very much on your being able to pick up on the gist or the schemas, and then have the schemas activate appropriate perceptual representations that are consistent with it. And we don't know where those perceptual representations arose. Either they arose because the schema activated the posterior neocortex, which it can do, or because it activated via the hippocampus posterior neocortical structures and make it vertical. I don't know what the answer is, but your point is well taken. Yes? There's a shift
from the neocortical movement to the hippocampal. What I mean is, does the information from the schema will decide what new information will be encoded in the I'm thinking about the bias of confirmation.
Yes, no, absolutely. I mean, the part of the studies that Asaf Gilboa and I want to do now is to try to understand how it is that these schema representations determine how it is we view the world, and then how it is that that interpretation then gets encoded in the hippocampus. Even in constructing, so this is a study done by Martin Addison Schachter, when you create a new memory, presumably under the guidance of these schemas, I don't know if Fellner is going to present some data to that effect, but maybe yes, maybe no, presumably under the guidance of these schemas, then your memory of what you've created is going to be hippocampally dependent. And there's a constant interaction between them, and I think we don't want to lose sight of that. I've focused only on two areas. There's other areas, clearly, that are implicated, the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, retrosplenial, and especially inferior parietal cortex come online too, and there's a different story for them that I didn't get into, but absolutely, you're absolutely right about that. Yes?
I have a question about Savant syndrome. What's different in their brain? What do they rely on, hippocampus or
prefrontal cortex? I do this all the time. I don't know the answer, but I probably should. And I don't know if there are any data on this at all. Somebody in this room might know. I don't know. It's a very good question. I just don't have a clue. I would suspect that. Let me move. I won't leave you with a blank. There are people who aren't savant in the sense that they don't have, not idiot savant, but real savants. In other words, people who have extraordinarily good memories, but they're not in any other way impaired. They seem to lead a more or less a normal life. They're intelligent, so on. But you can give them a date and ask them on this and that date, what did you do? What happened in the world, and they'll be able to tell you. They'll be incredibly accurate. It doesn't seem to be a hippocampus effect. And those individuals have been scans, McGaw and... Who? I can't hear.
Cahill.
Cahill, McGaw, no, but it's the woman from that she was in Toronto, worked with Endel, that I'm thinking about.
Betsy Parker.
Yeah, but before the scanning studies. And then Cahill and McGaw. And now Brian Levine at Toronto is collecting these people. The caudate seems to be implicated. Basal ganglia structures seem to be implicated in these people more than you would expect. The basal ganglia and caudate do show up on functional neuroimaging studies of memory, especially coming from Yadin Dudai's lab for autobiographical events. It seems to be a structure that's important. Exactly what it's doing there, we don't know. Some of these people seem to have obsessive compulsive characteristics, and maybe that's what's happening. It's not clear. So those people are being scanned. They're easier to scan. They're being looked at. You can follow the websites of Cahill and McGaw and Brian Levine to see how that research is coming along. Okay, so.
I have a question.
Oh, all right.
In the studies regarding the memory transformation, were there any level of processing manipulations? I mean, at the time of encoding or at the time of retrieval?
In which studies? Exactly. Which studies are you referring to?
In the studies that you mentioned regarding the memory transformation, because you mentioned just the difference between semantic aspects and the context.
We didn't. These studies really were much more naturalistic studies rather than studies that had to do with levels of processing, where usually you just give a single stimulus and you ask them to process to a deep or a shallow level. There are other studies that we've done that are sort of that way, where we ask people to make associations between famous and non-famous people and houses. And there are studies where we just show words, but we didn't do scanning studies with them and had people process them deeply or shallowly. What you get is an activation of the anterior temporal lobe more often than you get the ventromedial prefrontal cortex if it's just isolated words that have absolutely no event representation. So isolated words seem to be more semantic, categorical, and it draws on structures in the anterior temporal lobe and lateral temporal lobe that are semantically determined. If you look at famous faces, very many of the famous faces bring with them a kind of schema, because you often have not only have knowledge about this particular person, the knowledge is a rich one, not just mere semantic associations, and often they have personal significance. And then you do get the ventromedial prefrontal cortex coming online. Okay.
Other questions? No? Okay, thank you once again.
Thank you very much.